We're now going to question time, and can I call Mr. Edishank, please?
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for WorkSafe and the TAC, represented by the Leader of the Government, Minister Symes. It has long been established that psychological workplace hazards are no less harmful to employees than physical hazards. In 2021, the Victorian Government announced that the new psychological health regulations for Victorian employees were being developed and were expected to be released in that same year. According to the Victorian Government Solicitor's Office, following the completion of public consultation, the government has since been, quote, considering options for the development of regulations. So I ask the Minister, what is the status of these considerations?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Edishank for his question for Minister Pearson in the WorkSafe TSC capacity. As you know, it's an area where there's a lot of work going on, and I'd like to thank members from this chamber that have been involved in Parliamentary Committee considering similar topics, and I'm sure that Minister Pearson's office will prepare a thorough answer to Mr. Edishank's question.
Mr. Edishank, supplementary.
I thank the Minister for the Attorney for her assistance in this matter. By way of supplementary, Victoria was the first state in Australia to announce the development of psychosocial regulations for the workplace, but it is now the only state in Australia yet to implement those vital reforms. So my question is, when can we expect to see these regulations released?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I will add Mr. Edishank's second question to the first for Minister Pearson.
Thank you. Before I call the next question, I'd like to acknowledge in the gallery today we have a delegation from the State Legislative Assembly of Sabah from Malaysia, led by the Honourable Speaker, the two Deputy Honourable Speakers, Assistant Ministers and members of the Assembly. And on behalf of the Council, we welcome to the Parliament, and we hope when you leave, you judge our question time kindly. Ms. Crozier.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Mental Health. Minister, much-needed mental health support has been delayed for the devastated community of Pomonal because the government has not adequately funded support services. Yesterday, in question time in the other place, the Premier said she would, and I quote, immediately ask both the Minister for Emergency Services and the Mental Health Minister to understand what has happened here, end quote. Minister, what advice have you provided to the Premier?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And I thank Ms. Crozier for her question. It's an important one, and can I first acknowledge the significant impacts of the fires on the Pomonal community and the Grampians community more broadly, and acknowledge that these events has the capacity to have devastating impact on people's mental health and wellbeing, and it's something that the government is very committed to addressing, and there have been mental health services in place since the events occurred. There's a range of mental health supports available to residents of Pomonal, something that I have spoken to the member for Lowen about as early as this morning, and my office has also been in contact with her about these issues. We have Northern Grampians region covered by a range of different options for people in the community. Whenever there is an emergency situation like the one that we've seen in the Grampians, we do get immediate psychosocial and first aid provided by the Red Cross and the Victorian Council of Churches, who are in place now and have been since those events. We also have the Horsham Mental Health and Wellbeing Hub, which offers free walk-in and telehealth support, which can support residents who have been impacted by the fires. And as was noted yesterday in the Assembly, Grampians Community Health are also providing support to community members on the ground, and we're there. And I'd like to thank them for their support for the local community during what's been an incredibly difficult time. The Department of Health is currently in discussions with Grampians Community Health to ensure that they can continue to provide that on-ground support that's been there since day one. and it's really important that those supports are available for the local community, and those active conversations between the department and Grampians Community Health are ongoing to ensure that there is that support there at the time that we need it as we move from immediate relief to the recovery phase of this emergency.
Ms. Crozier, supplementary.
Didn't answer the question. Thank you, but thank you for the information nevertheless, Minister. Minister, it is well known the longer you leave mental health support after trauma, it is more likely to lead to post-traumatic disorder with higher rates of family violence and alcohol and other drug misuse. 8 days after the event, how long will the community have to wait before you provide this urgent funding that has been requested time and time again?
Minister.
Well, I don't know that Ms. Crozier has listened to my answer, President, because there have been significant supports in place since these terrible events unfolded, and nothing is more important than providing that immediate support to the community, and a number of us have been working hard on those issues since day one. The reality is that the conversations that are happening between the Department of Health and Grampians Community Health have no bearing on the fact that there are going to continue to be services available on the ground. I'd also make the point that there are a number of additional services available to the community across the Grampians because of the reforms that our government's pursuing, including the local services which have not been available up until quite recently. There will be people impacted by the emergency, but there will also be people who have been or have pre-existing mental health issues, and they will continue
Thank
to
you,
get
Minister,
that importance.
Minister.
Order.
Minister Sheen with the Minister's statement.
Thank you, President. I rise today in my capacity as Minister for Water to update the Chamber with the recent announcement of a $10 million investment program to improve habitat, water quality and to provide cool green spaces for communities around our urban creeks, rivers and waterways. 23 projects have been the recipients of the first round of this $10 million fund. This includes support for local councils, traditional owners, not-for-profit and community environmental groups, catchment management authorities and water corporations, with five large-scale catchment projects receiving grants and 18 successful local-scale community projects. And members will no doubt be delighted all around this chamber and indeed across the parliament to hear of the wide variety of waterways that will benefit, including the Birrarung, Maribyrnong, Kooyongkoot, Kororoit, Little River, Glen Iris Wetlands, Werribee River, Yeering, Billabong, Barwon and Moorabool River, Edgars Creek, Merry Creek, Yarraweed River, Mooney Ponds Creek, Steel Creek, Blackburn Lake, Stony Creek and Edwards Lake. So we're investing just over $6 million in total in this first round of projects with a further $4 million for future rounds to come. We've estimated that we will be able to revegetate around 200 hectares of land around our critical urban waterways. I'm really delighted to confirm, however, that this first round of grants alone is expected to revegetate over 300 hectares across Melbourne, Geelong and Ballarat. These are such an important part of the fabric of our urban environments and making sure that we have good landscapes for social, recreational, economic and environmental use is crucial, particularly in improving the health of rivers and creeks while we enjoy, walk along them and treasure them in our everyday. These have more than 1,800 species of native plants, 600 species of native animals, and congratulations to all successful applicants for their advocacy.
Ms. Purcell with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Racing in the other place. A Victorian greyhound recently died after having their barking muzzle left on in the scorching heat. The death is presumed to have occurred from either asphyxiation or dehydration. Greyhound Racing Victoria allegedly told the Kilmore-based trainer to take a photo and just drop the dog off at the vet for disposal. I only know of this death from whistleblowers, not from the industry being transparent. So can the Minister confirm the details of this death and if an autopsy was undertaken?
Minister.
President, and I thank Ms. Purcell for her question and interest in the greyhound racing sector. I know we've had an opportunity to visit one of our facilities where we have a partnership, a greyhound program where we were able to visit. I know you've been out there as well, and I thank you for your long-term passion and your interest in these matters. I'll pass that on to the Minister for Racing, the other place, and I'm sure he'll be able to respond to those questions as appropriate.
Ms. Purcell, for supplementary.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Minister, for referring that on. Victoria is already second in the country for on-track greyhound deaths, and almost 400 greyhounds have been injured on Victorian racetracks since the beginning of this year. While we know Victoria are leaders in serious on-track greyhound injuries and death, little is truly known about the incidents off the track like this one. Can the Minister advise how many dogs have been reported dead due to natural causes, accident, so-called misadventure, or any other reasons in the last year, and how many underwent autopsies to determine the cause of their deaths?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Purcell for a supplementary question and her interest in the greyhound industry, and I'll pass on to Mr. for Racing in the other place, and I'll seek a response in line with the standing orders.
Mr. Davis with a question, please.
President, my question is to the Minister for Emergency Services. Minister, Tuesday last week was the first catastrophic fire danger day declared since the 2019-20 Black Summer fires, and people in affected communities were advised to leave their homes on Monday night. And I ask, what additional firefighting aircraft were repositioned into the Wimmera region to deal with this catastrophic fire day?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I thank Mr. Davis for his question, and I certainly have a pre-prepared answer in relation to aerial firefighting, because comes up a lot in here. So I wanted to make sure that I had accurate information. We were very well protected and prepared with our firefighting aircraft on Tuesday. Obviously, they are a support to the on-the-ground efforts when we are dealing with fire incidences. 62 fire bombing and other aviation assets were made available ahead of the catastrophic fire day on Tuesday. They were repositioned across the state based on risk. In response to the fires in the Grampians, 27 aircrafts were dispatched over the 13th and 14th of February, including 17 water bombing and fire retardant aircrafts. I say this regularly, I don't deploy the assets, the experts deploy the assets. They are strategic decisions made by emergency response experts, and that's exactly how it should be. And as I have indicated before, the aerial fleet is a great asset, but they are there to support the on-the-ground efforts because there are instances where it's dangerous to fly, and so therefore there was a lot of aerial deployment and both during the fires and after. In Pomonal, I was there on Thursday and could see the aerial response in terms of suppression of that fire with dropping retardant, and there was a lot of the pink stuff floating around to ensure that community was protected from any sparks that could happen up after the main fire had been suppressed. So Mr. Davis, hopefully that answers your question in relation to the deployment of our aerial fleet.
Mr. Davis, supplementary.
I thank the Minister for her response, but actually it doesn't quite answer the question. I have a further point. Minister, given the extreme risk and the inaccessible terrain of much of the Wimmera region, why did Victoria only rely on smaller and mid-size aircraft instead of requesting large air tankers from interstate?
Minister.
Mr. Davis, again, we keep drawing into this conversation where you expect me as Minister for Emergency Services to be the person who makes operational decisions about which aircrafts are where. As I said, 62 firebombing and other aviation assets were made available on the day. I saw them myself. They were flying in the air, I can assure you. They were dropping wet stuff on the hot stuff, and it certainly helped the suppression and the protection of those communities.
Mr. Davis, a point of order.
President, it's a very, very specific question about why Victoria relied on smaller and mid-size aircraft instead of requesting large air tankers from interstate. The Minister has actually not responded to that at all.
Mr. Davis, the Minister's been relevant to the question that she's been asked.
Not to the air tanker.
Minister, or that's it? Yeah. Mr. Davis.
I take the Minister's answer on notice for the next day of meeting.
Question is, the Minister's answers be on notice for debate and the next day of meeting? All that opinions say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. Minister Tini with the Minister's statement.
Thank you, President. And today I rise to commend the resilience and community spirit of our regional Victorian communities. I've seen firsthand how regional Victorians are supporting each other following the horrific storm event and fires on the 13th of February. Last weekend, I had the opportunity to visit Pomonal, where a significant number of homes have been lost to bushfires. The Pomonal General Store, where I was able to meet with local community leaders, has become a rallying point for the town. And I've got to say, President, one of the first questions I asked of community members is, are the mental health services in place? Are they available? They assured me they were, and in fact had been accessed, President. I was able to thank the brave Pomonal CFA volunteers, seven of whom had lost their own homes while fighting to save the homes of others. And I'd like to acknowledge all first responders who are still working on recovery and clean-up efforts. I also met the Mayor and the CEO of the South Gippsland Shire Council, who are leading very significant clean-up jobs in Mirrabooka North and surrounds. Again, the amazing work of Council staff and community volunteers is shining through. Enormous effort is required as we transition from frontline response to the recovery phase. And I've also been deeply impressed by the optimism of impacted communities and the many practical ideas to support recovery, including directly from residents like Pomonal business owner Damon and his partner Tash. As Minister for Regional Development, I want to make it clear that we recognise the importance of community-led responses, and your ideas are being taken back to government. And my focus is on listening to these communities to determine the best way that place-based support can be provided to build resilience, to build stronger regions, President.
Mr. Limbrick, with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister representing the Minister for Government Services and is related to Births, Deaths and Marriages Services. And I can almost hear the collective sigh from my colleagues around the chamber. This isn't the first time I've raised issues with this service, and I'm not the only member of this chamber to raise them. When I raised this matter in August last year, requesting that the office be reopened and services restored to adequate levels, I also questioned whether it was permanently closed and whether rent was being paid on an empty office. The Minister didn't state this in his response, but it does seem that the office has indeed been permanently closed. I haven't heard any announcements, but there's no longer an address listed on their website. My question for the Minister is, why has the Births, Deaths and Marriages office closed?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I will ensure that Minister Williams provides a response to Mr. Limbrick.
Mr. Limbrick, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Attorney-General for passing that on for me. My supplementary question, if this is simply part of the streamlining and cost-cutting measures that the government is implementing to pay for the largesse of the COVID spending era, then fair enough. I'm hardly one to oppose savings measures. However, this is hardly a grant for some new weird art installation, but a critical service that people need to engage with a lot of other services. When I last spoke about this issue, the rating on Google for births, deaths and marriages was 1.7 out of 5. Remarkably, it has fallen, despite assurances from the Minister that they were focusing on improving service delivery. At 1.6 stars, the stories reflect the same things, such as people paying three times for a simple document, not receiving it, and not receiving a reply to emails. Another person explained that it took 4.5 months for the complaint to get to the Ombudsman to get a birth certificate. I asked the Minister what is being done to ensure adequate service delivery for people trying to access or alter these critical documents.
Minister.
Thank you, President. Mr. Limbrick, I will add your second question to your first.
Mr. McCracken with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is also to the Minister for Emergency Services. Minister, two small lightning strikes last week and a lack of suitable air response resources last Tuesday let fires grow and cause huge losses in Western Victoria, which is my electorate. So my question is, what additional firefighting aircraft are allocated to the extreme risk regions ahead of tomorrow's predicted dangerous conditions?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And Mr. McCracken, I don't purport to be a person that can determine what you've alleged to believe is the cause of fires or the spread of fires in your region. So to make an assertion that aerial fleet deployment is something that you think was wrong is not something that I think you're qualified to assert. Having said that, I have responded to the incidents of the 13th, 14th of February in relation to deployment around the state. I have not received advice about where planes and choppers are ahead of tomorrow, because I trust that the experts are making those decisions today. Not only are the assets, they're not all at one place permanently anyway. They are at Ballarat, they're at Avalon, they're at Stawell, they're at Moorabbin. There are different homes for them, and they get strategically moved around the state responding to risk. Tomorrow's weather is looking like extreme for the Wimmera, for the parts of central and southwest, which is where the experts will be focused on tomorrow, making sure that our brigades are ready, making sure that all of the support is available for those communities where we know there will be high risk. Off the back of last week's weather, we know that there is further drying of particularly grasslands. So grass fires is a particular focus of our agencies tomorrow, and aerial fleet are a very good asset to respond to grass fires because they move very quickly. So air attacks are a great way to attack those fires because it's a bit more difficult for some of our vehicles to be able to keep up with those. So it is an additional asset that I'm sure will be deployed by the experts to the areas of risk.
Mr. McCracken, supplementary.
Thank you for that response, Minister. Will you provide the House with a copy of the air operations plan before the close of business today, yes or no?
Minister.
Mr. McCracken, well, you're seeking an answer outside of the standing orders. However, I don't have a problem in providing information about the amazing work that our emergency services do in relation to preparing and responding to high-risk weather incidences. I'm more than happy to come back to you and provide you with as much information as I possibly can in relation to the preparedness for tomorrow. The air operational, it's not a static document. It might change in the morning depending on what the Bureau tell us. If you want a career change and become an aerial expert, then perhaps go and do that. I am not the aerial expert. I rely on the information that I get from I can assure the community that the communities are safe. We have a asset range that go from the ground
to
the air, which we deploy.
Thank you, Minister. Time's expired.
That's a no.
Minister Blanford and Minister's statement.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House on how the Allan Labor government is encouraging Victorians from all walks of life to consider a career in child protection. I've spoken many times in this House about the work we have undertaken to strengthen the child protection workforce through funding 1,180 additional child protection practitioners to promoting their vital work through the Go Where You're Needed campaign. But today I want to focus on the Child Protection Vacation Employment Program. Most recently funded through the 22-23 budget, this $5.4 million program provides a paid rotation-based employment program that equips Victorian-based students studying a social work, psychology, welfare or related qualification with the experience and skills necessary for entry-level child protection practitioner roles. Last year I attended the graduation of 56 participants of this program, and on that day I was particularly struck by the story of one of the previous participants. And for the benefit of the House, I highlight their story, and to protect their identity, I refer to them as Jill. Jill began her tertiary studies with the intention of working in criminology and the Australian Federal Police. However, the pandemic delayed her fitness tests that were required for her to join the AFP, and during the pandemic she couldn't sit still, and her passion for learning led her to consider free TAFE, and before she knew it she had started a diploma of community services. Working as a disability support worker gave her exposure to advocating for those most at risk in our community. As part of her placement requirement, she applied for the Child Protection Vacation Employment Program and put her career in disability on hold to try something new. In early 22, she was able to experience and learn more than she could ever imagine. She saw the work and efforts of child protection in areas such as intake, investigation, case management, and witness practitioners' advocacy for children. She saw the difference child protection can make in a child's life just by taking an interest in what they had to say and making them feel safe. By the time she had finished the program, she had accepted a position in child protection intake. The team were so welcoming, knowledgeable and supportive that she knew it would be the perfect environment for her. Jill was a very impressive young woman, and this is just one example of how our investments are making delivering child
protection. Dr. Mansfield with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Water. The Victorian Labor Government has banked heavily on 9 floodplain restoration projects proposed to achieve its environmental water targets under the Murray-Darling Basin Plan. In January, your own government's planning minister, Sonia Kilkenny, rejected the Burra Floodplains Restoration Project on environmental grounds. She found that the project posed an unacceptable environmental risk due to loss of native vegetation. There are similar environmental concerns at the other planned floodplain restoration project sites. Minister, in light of the planning minister's decision, will you reconsider the pursuit of these projects?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Dr. Mansfield, for again enabling me the opportunity to talk about the VMFRP and these exceptionally important projects which are about returning environmental benefit to parts of our floodplain where water will not reach unless we have catastrophic floods, the likes of which we saw in October 2022. We make absolutely no apology for using proven technology in pumps and in regulators to get water to parts of the landscape that need it, to build a measure of climate resilience, and to make sure that we can get water to 14,000 pristine and crucially precious landscaped areas, including a number which are the subject of consideration and protection under the Ramsar Convention. We know that these are parts of the state where the floodplain has attracted hundreds of native species of flora and fauna. We know also that when we can mimic natural flows using this established and proven technology, pumps and regulators, there is nothing new in this. You would do well to acquaint yourself with the way that it works. We can not only save vast amounts of water, but we can make sure that watering takes place to realise those long-term environmental objectives. Dr. Mansfield, it would be foolhardy in the extreme to say that because one project has not received approval that every other project should not therefore be pursued. In fact, to do so would be, I would suggest, anathema to the Greens' own objectives of making sure that environments in Victoria receive the benefit of innovation. And the remaining projects that we have will enable us to stop the deterioration of landscapes by offsetting more than 70 gigalitres of water that will otherwise need to be found through the Commonwealth's ill-considered program to restore water to the environment through the blunt instrument of buybacks. So we are committed to the VMFRP. We are committed to making sure that we restore the health of these floodplains across these sites, including the National Parks estate, without the need to flood towns. And when we do talk about managing these balances, when we do talk about bringing water onto these floodplains, it is with a view to making sure that as we experience hotter and drier climatic conditions, as we experience less water in the environment, we have those measures in place to bring that water onto floodplains, to mimic natural flows, to ensure that we have migratory bird and other species returning to breeding in and ensuring the health of these landscapes. These rigorous assessment processes have found that we have overall benefits across sites at Hatter Lakes North, Belsa, Yungara, Nyer and Vinifera, and we do want to make sure that this work continues. I look forward to you getting on board to see these benefits realised.
Dr. Manfield, supplementary.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Minister, for your response. I'll take that as a yes, you do intend to pursue these projects. However, your government's failure to sign the new Murray-Darling Basin Agreement federally means that Victoria will get no Commonwealth funding to support these floodplain projects should they ever get past your own planning minister. And you failed to answer previous questions I've asked regarding how you intend to fund these incredibly expensive projects. Minister, given Victoria's achievement of environmental water targets depends on these floodplain restorations projects being operational, and they appear to be unable to get funding or planning approval, how do you intend to meet your environmental water targets under the Murray-Darling Basin Plan?
Minister.
Thank you very much. What a shame I only have a minute. It's tempting to ask for additional time to address what you've posed in your supplementary question. Dr. Mansfield, the objectives of delivering the VMFRP projects are entirely aligned with the Commonwealth's legislation as it passed last year. In fact, for the Commonwealth not to fund these projects would be for it to abandon the principles which underpin the legislation that it championed last year. In fact, not to fund these projects would be to act anathema to the objectives of what the federal minister referred to as restoring our rivers. We are in a position to return with additional time, which I have pushed for, which my predecessor pushed for, 95%
Dr.
of Mansell, our targets under the plan.
Minister, Dr. Mansell, with point of order.
I appreciate that the Minister's sort of addressing parts of the question, but she's not actually answering my question, which was how will you meet the environmental water targets?
I believe the Minister's been relevant to the question. I think she was rejecting the premise about there won't be any Commonwealth funding. Once again, I shouldn't paraphrase and I'll get myself into trouble, but I'll call the Minister.
The legislation requires, in fact, that the Commonwealth does fund projects, including those under the VMFRP. I'm looking forward to seeing the Commonwealth deliver on its promises to do exactly that.
Mr. Mulholland, with a question, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to the Minister for Emergency Services. Minister, last Tuesday was the first declared catastrophic fire danger day since the 2019-20 Black Summer fires, and people in affected communities were advised to leave their homes on Monday night. What coordination took place for strike teams to be in place in the affected areas?
Thank you, President, and I thank Mr. Mulholland for his question, but I think the way you've characterised your question, we were well prepared. We knew that it was going to be a catastrophic day. Communities were warned and the State Control Centre was activated accordingly. And strike teams were in place. I'm not sure what you're concerned about in relation to the state's preparedness. I am very confident in the State Control Centre and their ability to keep Victorians safe.
Mr. Mulholland, supplementary.
Minister, will there be a review into the failings that occurred in fighting the fires in Western Victoria on the 13th of February, and when will it be released?
Minister?
And I think some of the interjections probably are consistent with my gut response to that question. The volunteers, the paid personnel, communities responded incredibly to a catastrophic day. They saved lives, they saved properties, and I thank them for that effort. I wouldn't characterise it as a review into failings. I commend everyone who responded on the day and thank them for their efforts. Yes, we always look at every emergency. We have a review that commences before the emergency is even completed. We will always look for continual improvements. Absolutely. I am on record of saying that no response is ever perfect. It never will be. We will always learn from every emergency, but I will not attack those that responded on last Tuesday.
Order. Very good. Minister Symes with a minister's statement, I believe. No. All right. So that's the end question times and minister's statements.